This past week, we've been talking about victory. So laying the foundation of victory was last Sunday. Today will be the path to victory. Next Sunday, we will discuss securing victory. Amen? I'd like to give you a quote by Winston Churchill. I'd like you to remember this quote because I know that it was back in World War II. But I tell you guys, let me give you some news. We're in a war today. And there is no substitution for victory. Say it with me. There is no substitution for victory. So there is no plan B. Either you win or you lose. Amen? So whenever Winston Churchill came before the House of Commons, his first speech as the Prime Minister of Great Britain, he said, "You ask, what is my aim? And I can answer with one word. It is victory. It is victory at all cost, victory in spite of all terror, victory however long and hard the road may be, for without victory there is no survival." Those are powerful words. This one man was standing against the hellacious tyranny of Adolf Hitler. No one else was, everyone else ran in fear. France crumbled in a day out of fear. You see, the battle and the battle area that we fight is our minds. Either you win it or you lose it right here. Is that true? It's true. And so one man came out of the shadows named Winston Churchill, and guess what? He was not scared of Adolf Hitler. Right. They say that the people were in the room with Hitler when he heard this speech and heard another subsequent speech, and said he literally physically changed in his appearance, because all of a sudden the one that had been terrorizing now saw his own fate before his eyes. Amen. When you have determination, you can win the battle. Last week we said that you have to know three areas. You have to know yourself. Hope you're taking notes on some of this. You have to know yourself. You have to know your enemy. And you have to know your environment. Let me make some points, just recapping last Sunday's message. You have to know who you are in Christ. First and foremost, I must know who I am. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. This is just a recap from last week. In knowing myself, I have to know that I am a new creature through Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ," where? Where? About Christ? Near Christ? In Christ. Amen? And so if I find myself in Christ, that person that's in Christ is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Say all things. Now, it doesn't mean that everybody around you is going to forget your past. That's right. Your mama's not going to forget your past. The people who you have hurt in yesterday are not going to forget your past. In fact, and the devil's not going to forget your past. In fact, every time he gets a chance, he's going to try to bring it back up, to throw it in your face and say, you once were, you're still that. And you have to be confident in who you are in Christ and say, I'm not that person. When I'm outside of Jesus, all manner of things can go wrong. But when I find myself in Jesus, I'm a new creature. Amen? And so when the enemy tries to throw your weaknesses at you, you say, yes, I'm weak, but I am strong in Christ. I find my security in Christ. When the enemy says you don't have the answer for your family or your finances or your marriage or your church, you say, I don't have the answer, but I find myself in Christ. That is the sure foundation that you can build your life on, your future on, your business on. Oh, you're everything about you, God is concerned. You see, in the United States, in a Western culture, we compartmentalize. It does. We say, okay, separation of church and state. We try to keep Jesus in church on Sunday morning, but don't let him get in your family or your job or your businesses, right? That's the way they want it. But that is not the way it should be or it is. I don't care how hard you try to compartmentalize your life. If you love Jesus Christ, he is going to be in your family. He's going to be on your job. He's going to be with your friends. And he's going to be at your church. Amen. Because if I'm a new creature on Sunday morning, I'm a new creature on Monday morning. Amen. Don't fall into the trap of saying that you have to compartmentalize your life and keep Jesus separate. That's a good point. It can't happen. Because you and I must stand securely on Jesus Christ. This is all about knowing me. Now, that's a good part right there. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, it says we're supposed to set our eyes on Jesus. We're to cast off the weights and those sins that so easily beset us. Say, I got to know me. I got to know what derails me. Amen. I have to know where I'm strong in the spirit and where I'm weak in the spirit. Some people can quote scripture and they can quote it all day long, but they don't pray at all. Right? You know, I don't Google my messages. No, I love Google. And Google helps me. When I try to get a different translation or if I'm looking up a word, yeah, I'm going to pull up some biblical websites and pull out some different items. But I don't go to Google and get my message. Some pastors do that. You can have them prefab, ready to go. 12 months worth of sermons. 12 months. They give you a whole year. All you do is take the title off, put your title on it, and stand up and rehearse what you got. It's like singing somebody else's song every day instead of worshiping from your heart. I think a preacher and a minister has to at least spend some time with Jesus to figure out what he's doing. I spend time with the Lord. I ask God about what does this church need about victory. And the Lord began to open up in my life. They've got to know themselves. They've got to know their enemy. And they've got to know their environment if they want victory. Amen. So one area about knowing yourself is you have to know your strengths and your weaknesses. Sometimes your strengths can be a weakness. Think about it. Because you can have so much confidence in your strength that it leads to pride and hubris. It is. I've known some very good, it's called an Achilles heel. You can be strong. But that if you have too much confidence in your own strength, you can become blind and arrogant. So if I know that I naturally have an inclination to worship or to declare, but if I don't have a natural inclination to pray, then what I need to do is work on me. I have to pray. Some people naturally do that. Others do not. Some will pray but don't read scripture. So that means that I need to start taking time out of my schedule and sit down, and instead of watching 50 movies on Netflix that week, I'm going to take 2 hours and I'm going to pray, I'm going to read the Word and learn how to study God's Scripture, amen? So it takes an investment. To know yourself, you have to know who you are in Christ. You are going to push back any negative images. You're going to identify your strengths and your weaknesses. That means if you know a certain sin crouches at your door and you are vulnerable to that sin, don't take the bait. Amen? You have to know yourself. Secondly, you got to know your enemy. You have to know what his goal is, what his playbook is to accomplish his agenda. Can you say amen? And you got to know how he attacks. So John 10:10 says, the thief cometh but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. So anytime you sense strife or a sin or anything happening around you, if you take the bait and fall into the devil's trap, let me tell you the outcome is going to be death and destruction, and he's going to try to steal something, right? So don't think you can play with the devil and then somehow get something else out of it than killing, stealing, and destroying. Now in Daniel 7:25 says that the enemy, that Antichrist spirit, tries to what? Wear out the saints. So this is what the enemy tries. He tries to get you so burdened with life and stress that you give up. Say, I'm not giving up. Now see, the enemy's already defeated, so he cannot defeat you. He tries to wear you out so much that you give up. Don't give up. You already have the victory. Sometimes you just need to extricate yourself from the problem long enough to get renewal. Sometimes the enemy wants us to get into an intractable situation, one where we're constantly in the battle and can get no relief. Just change the dynamic. Now, also, in Daniel 7:25 says that the enemy tries to change the times and seasons. He wants to attempt to change the times and seasons. That's a crucial goal from last Sunday's message. That the enemy likes to, he wants to what? Change my season. He wants to disrupt my cycle. If you weren't here last Sunday, you need to get that message, because the enemy wants to disrupt and derail your cycle. The cycle of renewal, of rebirth, and harvest. You see, God is the one who has a cycle in your life. He has a springtime, he has a summertime, he has a fall, he has a winter. Every living thing has a cycle for life. So what happened? What does the devil want? He wants to get and disrupt that cycle so he can cost you your refreshing and cost you your harvest. But Galatians states very clearly that if you do not grow weary in well-doing, you shall have your harvest in what? In a due season. Now, let me tell you, when you've got, if you've ever had a baby or had a baby in your family, you know that there is a process that happens and there is a due date. When you go to church and the power of God touches you and you accept the vision and the word of the Lord in your life, let me tell you something. You are pregnant with the vision of God and there is a due date coming. God does not, so nowhere in Scripture, okay, you can show me that God sows seed in someone's life and does not desire a full harvest from you. I can show you Isaiah 55, 10 and 11 that says his word comes down and it accomplishes that which he sent. It means that God's word is seed and it is encoded with a certain purpose. Say amen. Now, if I came up here in the physical and I had corn, kernels of corn, if I had squash, I had some kind of melon, I had seeds laid out. And maybe I don't know what those seeds were all jumbled up. Maybe I go out and plant them. I'm going to tell you something. Those seeds are already encoded with what they're going to produce. All because I don't know what it is doesn't mean it ain't going to come up what's already encoded in it, right? When God's word is planted in our hearts and received well, according to the parable of the sower. Amen. Jesus said the preacher is the one that goes out and casts the seed. He says the enemy comes immediately. That means you may get a good word this morning or last Sunday, between the time that you leave this place and go up to the local restaurant where you're going to fill your belly. The enemy is going to try to pluck up out of your life between here and there. And you have a choice to either accept it or reject it. Right? God literally, there was a moment, Abraham, Jacob, one of them had a sacrifice. And I remember, where's Vicky at? Who beat off the birds? Was it Abraham? Abraham made a sacrifice unto God. You know, the fire of God did not, and this deep sleep came upon him. And I remember this one verse. The moment he sacrificed, the power of God didn't just fall. He had to beat the birds off. The enemy tries to come and pick the word out of your life. And what you've got to say is no. You cannot have my cycle for renewal. You cannot have my harvest. You cannot take from me. You know, you're going to have opportunity to get in a fight today. Uh-oh. Right? Choose not to show up to his fight. Just hug somebody. We're going to get there. Know yourself. Know your enemy. Your enemy wants to wear you out. He wants to kill, steal, and to destroy. And he wants to bait you into conflict. So stay out of conflict. Know how he works. And just tell him to go away. Know your environment. Your environment is your season. Know your season. Know your due date. I remember whenever Deidre was with Easton and with child, and we were going to the doctor, and we had to go through so many vitamins in this trimester, and we had to do this. And so I was out there. Every time she'd wake up, I had her vitamins out. She had to have folic acid because I wanted my baby's brain to work, Mama. Some days I wonder if I gave him a little too much folic acid. You know, because he's smart and he'll say things. I'm like, man, we should have cut back on your folic acid. But you're so conscious of your season when you have a baby, when it's a life that God's making you responsible for. You're going through it, you're studying all these charts, and are they within a certain range? Are they normal or abnormal in weight and size and so forth? And if he's underweight, what do? We started putting half and half in his milk. That's what the doctor said. Said, give him ice cream and give him half and half. I can tell you it has worked. He has broken out of that stage. The other day he was laying on the couch and watched that nutrition commercial with the woman dropping the weight. And he said he was just sitting there watching TV, and he looked at me and said, Daddy. And I said, yes, baby. He says, I sure need some of that. I said, baby, you don't need Nutrisystem. You are 10 years old. You just need to drop the cupcake. You need to put the ice cream up. You need a little self-control at 10. That's all. You don't need Nutrisystem. Fast 5 plus. That's what he says. The other day, I forgot. I was trying to say something. I forgot my wording. And he was in the back of the seat. And he says, Daddy, you need Prevagen. That's what I said. Lord, have mercy. So when he was a baby and he was developing and we were so anticipating his birth, we wanted to do everything right. I wouldn't let Deidre drink coffee. You know what I mean? And there were so many things that we began to work in our lives because we were anticipating the baby. And if you know what season you're in, then you know what you need to be doing in anticipation of your harvest. But you have to go to Jesus, and that's First Chronicles 12:32 is one that we use a lot, but he says the sons of Issachar had a gift of God to know the times and season and what decisions Israel ought to make. I'm going to tell you, if God will give us wisdom and we've got to ask for it, he will give it to us liberally, abundantly. Then if I don't know my season and if I don't know, I got to go to God and ask him, reveal it to me. And he will send someone to you. He will either speak to you directly, he'll send a preacher to preach the word. But God in this ministry today has sent me here to say to you, you've got to know your season. Because if you know the season, you know exactly what action to take to be successful at that moment. I want to know my season. The enemy wants you to get distracted and bound up in a bunch of conflict and strife that doesn't mean anything. Is it right? I think it's correct. I think the enemy wants to get us so bound up in the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches that it chokes out the word. It is. Because God has called me to lead. God's called you to lead. You are not a follower. You are a follower of Jesus, but you are not a follower of your circumstances. You will not be led by the enemy. You are called to lead yourself. You are called to lead your families. You are to lead. And if you feel that your situation is overwhelming you, it is time to step up and lead. You want revival? Lead. Amen. I'd like you to remember that our enemy is a terrorist. He uses fear and terrorism because he is weaker than we are. Now, I told you, he's got fangs. I admit he has fangs. But God has given us a big old stick to beat that devil out of our lives. Amen. So, God has called us to realize something. Through the power of the cross and the power of his blood, you have victory now. It doesn't mean you don't have to work for it or fight for it. It just means you have access to the victory that is supplied at the cross through the presence and the blood of Jesus Christ. So you got to know your enemy is a terrorist. He wants to make you fearful. Terrorism is employed. This is a statement that I would like you to write down and to remember. Terrorism is employed by an adversary not to break an opponent's ability to fight, but rather to break an opponent's will to fight. Terrorism is employed not to break an opponent's ability to fight. Terrorism is used to break your will to fight. You see, Al-Qaeda cannot go against our ISIS or anything else. They cannot go against the might of our military, one-for-one soldiers, one-for-one technology. We have the highest technology, but guess what? Stealth technology and the weapons that we have cannot defeat fear. It's true. So ISIS uses these campaigns of fear, whether it be beheadings or these mass killings in these very graphic ways. They do that to invoke one thing: fear. They cannot stop our military, but they can try to break the will of the American people to fight. Al-Qaeda was pretty smart in their strategy when they attacked the Twin Towers. They wanted to bring and draw the United States into a conflict in Afghanistan because Afghanistan is known as the area where empires go to die. And their goal was not to defeat us one for one. They don't have the technology to defeat our technology, but they knew that they could hit the United States in a very broad and open way. We would be drawn into Afghanistan, and that's the place that so many empires have collapsed economically, trying to fight that one area. That was his strategy. Pretty smart. Guess what? We're still in Afghanistan. It's the longest going American war. So our enemy wants to not, he's not concerned about breaking our, he cannot break our ability to fight. The weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. But if he can wear you out and terrorize you, then he'll break your will to fight. When you come to the house of God and you see that so many individuals at once were calling out for revival are no longer even in church. You see, I don't judge them. I'm not discrediting them. I'm just saying that somewhere along the way, they lost their will to fight for it. So we have to ask God to rekindle the fire. Amen? Today, getting into the actual path to victory, I'd like to tell you there are three areas that you're going to engage your enemy. One is you're going to break his alliances. So don't partner with the devil. Don't partner with the enemy. Number one, you're going to break his alliances. Number two, you're going to spoil his plots. If you see the enemy trying to break up your home, break up your finances, break up your peace, then you know that you've got to go to war. But you try to break his plot. So number one, break his alliances, spoil his plots. And then thirdly, besiege his strongholds. Now on the flip side, say the flip side. If I've got to break the enemy's alliances, I've got to spoil his plots and strategies, and I've got to besiege his strongholds, then I am required to, number one, build alliances in my life. I am secondly required. If I want to have victory, I must have alliances in my life. I must have unity. Secondly, I must formulate strategies. And thirdly, I've got to fortify my defenses. Now, to build alliances is about having unity in the body of Christ. How many of you in this house want to have victory? Amen. Raise your hand if you want victory. You want victory in your families. You want victory in your church. You want family. You want all of us to have victory, right? Guess what? You've got to have unity in your family. You've got to unify with your spouse and your loved ones. You have to unify with those that are with you. You've got to be of one mind and one accord with the same purpose. If you're divided, if a husband and wife are divided for about a bloodline, you're not going to have victory. You've got to spend time getting on the same page. If a church wants to have victory in a territory, the body in that church and leadership must be on the same page. So you got to build alliances, not partnerships. Alliances. There's a difference. You see, you can partner with anybody. You see, a partnership, in the old adage, is that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. See, a partnership is out of convenience. It has common interests. Say common interest. So, like for instance, in World War II, I love studying history because we tend to repeat it. So, we were able to partner with Great Britain and Russia. But the moment that the Nazis were defeated, what happened? The Russians became the Soviet Union, and we went to the Cold War for 70 years. So, as long as we were fighting against Japan and the Nazis in Italy, they were the enemy of my enemy is my friend. But the day that it was over, baby. It's in. So that's called a partnership. When you look in the Middle East, we have a lot of partnerships with Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Iraq. We have partnerships, but we have one ally in the Middle East, Israel. You see, the difference between a partner and an ally is that an ally has shared values. Right? So whenever I look at the nation of Israel, we have shared values of freedom, human dignity, based upon Scripture. So we have shared values. We're allies. We're not just partners. When I tell you, number one, you've got to bring forth an alliance in your life, you have to ally with those that are closest to you. I'm talking about those that have shared values. It's easy to come into this room right now and for us to ally together because we believe certain fundamentals of the faith. We believe in the power of Jesus Christ. We believe. It's not about saying that we are perfect. It means that we are becoming perfect or mature in Him. See, we believe in Jesus. I can align with you. Formulate strategies is number two. If you're going to get anywhere, You have got to sit down with your allies, and you have got to formulate a strategy for success. You can't get a strategy if you don't know what to accomplish. So if you want revival in your home and family, if you want peace and security, if a church wants to have revival in an open heaven, then you have to visualize that, but get a strategy of how you're going to get there. Partner with people. Partner, ally with you with those that are around you. It takes a work. It takes work, prayer, intercession. It takes fasting. It takes so much to have revival. Not pushing the hand of God, but figuring out what season I'm in. God, what are you doing? I want to align with you, and I want to have the best outpouring, the most fruitfulness I can have in the season I'm in. And then fortify your defenses. You know how the enemy works. That means you have a no strife memo passed out to everybody around you. Learn how to communicate maturely. Amen? Paul said it this way. He said, you know, I can't even feed y'all a bunch of steak because you're still babies, because you're still carnal, because you're still fighting. That's what Paul said. So, I mean, and we'll look at that scripture in just a moment, but literally he's saying if you're fighting, if you got strife in your life, you're being a baby. Grow up. I want to give you some steak, but you're going to choke on steak. My dad used to come up and preach about having to part a man's mustache to put his bottle in. Y'all remember that statement? And that was funny, right? It was real funny, but he was real serious too, because he was really tired of parting mustaches and shoving a bottle in when they should be eating steak. In fact, if the body of Christ can only function, it's when the men of a church are godly and they know the struggles that men have in life, and yet they will raise up younger men to be godly men. When women of the church, which have gone through hard things in life, begin to mentor younger women and say, look, it's hard being a godly woman, but let me tell you how I did in my life. You see, it takes so much in our lives to mature. But if we have been in the body of Christ, been saved for 20, 30, 40 plus years, it's time that we stop get off the milk and start teaching and preaching God's word. If you've been saved for 10 or 15 years or 40 plus years, you have a witness. What is your witness? What is your testimony? I fought hell. And hell lost. Tell me how. The enemy wanted to kill me, but I'm still here. I remember the miracles. You may be talking to somebody who's never seen a miracle. Tell them about the miracles you've seen of God. Amen. It's time to dream and to believe. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, I'd like to give you this passage. And I actually will watch my time today, potentially, even though I don't have any way to do that right now. So what time is it? It's what? 12:14. So if you're out by 2:14, we're going to be great. I'm not going to do that. Last week I did preach an hour and 15, 20 minutes, something like that. I just miss you. Matthew chapter 5, verse 9 says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Do you know that it is easier to wage war than it is to build the peace? It's easier to go to attack and to fight than it is to build something. It's easier to tear something down than it is to build. It takes a lot of work to build something. And the word peacemaker, blessed are those who love peace, is one translation. One translation says, blessed are those that work for peace. Blessed are those who are peacemakers. Find areas of your life where you can build peace. Amen. people that you've lost contact with, that once you were close with, but maybe estranged through different conflicts or so forth and misunderstandings. Why not be a peacemaker instead of a war wager? Amen? Maybe the closest people around you, you need to go to and say, I want to make peace with you. One item that I have, and a goal that I have, is I don't burn bridges. It is. Because, you know, maybe you want to cross it over one day. I don't know. But I don't like having a life to where I look back on and I see a bunch of burned bridges. I don't like that. Some people have their whole life is marred by broken relationships. And I've had opportunities that the easiest way is to just let it burn and walk on. How many of you know that? And life is hard, so I'm not going to give you the circumstance I'm thinking about, but there are some many, many hard places I've been. One took me 5 years. 5 years of constant work to rebuild a bridge, just to have a bridge. And to undo what had happened. Wasn't my fault, wasn't their fault, but both of us really got hurt. It happens. It does. Life isn't fair. If somebody told you that it was going to be fair and easy when you got saved, they were new. They just got saved that morning. Because when you've been in for a while, you have every opportunity to quit, to give up, to be offended. You know, sometimes it ain't easy. But I can stand here before you today, and I can tell you that there are some relationships that have not been mended. But I've done my. Sometimes we just said, "I love you and forgive you, love you and forgive you," and we don't talk anymore. But we did bury the hatchet. Others, relationships, the one that I did spend 5 years to restore, we have open communication to this day. I benefit him and his ministry, and he benefits me in mine. We call and talk for an hour. But it took he and I both being on the phone one day where he was in tears, grown man, he's in tears crying, asked me to forgive him, I'm in tears crying, I say, I'm asking you to forgive me where I hurt you. That's tough, guys. I'm not saying it's not easy. But it's easier to be someone that wages war than it is to make peace. I'm asking you, if you want victory, your one path, you have to have this on your path to victory. The enemy, if he wants victory, he wants you in strife. If you want to have victory in the church and in your Christian walk with God, you've got to make peace. To make peace means you have to walk in forgiveness. And you have to have compassion. You've got to forgive somebody that actually hurt you, even when they intended to hurt you, and you still have to forgive them. That means they strategize of how they're going to hurt you. They spend hours thinking about how they're going to take from you. It's not just a one-off. I'm talking about they worked to hurt you. You still have to walk in forgiveness and operate in compassion. I have had individuals who have worked to hurt me, but later on needed me and called me, and you guess what? I still showed up because I did what I did as a minister unto Jesus Christ. Now, I didn't get sucked into their life and went to work for them. You know, I don't let them just call up every day and occupy all my time, but I did not harbor ill will toward them, even though they worked very hard to hurt me. Say it ain't easy. Especially when it's in the body of Christ. I'm talking about people in the church. I'm not talking about the devil. When the world hurts you, guess what? That's their nature. When you're in the body of Christ, it's almost you think, a little bit better. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. We're still talking about the path to victory is called peace. You will only have peace in your life. Peace is the substance of walking in forgiveness and compassion. So when somebody hurts you, the first thing you do is you have grace toward them. You know, I think the best of people. I try. No, I do. I trust first instead of withholding trust and make you earn it. I'd rather just trust you. It's too much work for me to worry about whether or not I can trust you. I'm going to just trust you. Now, that means I'm going to throw all my business out. But at the same time, I'm going to trust you first. And I'm going to think the best of you. If somebody comes to me and says, you know, I heard something about so-and-so. You know, I heard something about Brother Justin. Well, first and foremost, I'm going to say, well, that's not what I know of him. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt than saying, mm-hmm. That's what I thought. Right? Because I want you to, if somebody spoke ill of me, I hope my character speaks enough. You know, I'm not perfect. I may think none of us are. I mean, some days I may wake up feeling more perfect than others. But I'm not perfect. Benefit of the doubt. If I hear something about one of my friends, that one of my allies, let me get real with you. One of my allies that I build with, that I work with, I have a great team at Liberty, guys that I love on this team. If somebody says something negative about them, the first thing I'm going to say is, mm-mm. You are not going to divide me from my allies. You're not going to have me having strife with the ones that I fight with every day and build every day. Yes, they may make a mistake, but at the heart, they're not that way. Amen? So when you're in the body of Christ or your own family, guess what something? If you turn on your family, they steal your family. You can't just buy a new mama or a new daddy or a new brother or a new sister. You can't turn on those that are in your family. I'm preaching a lot. Okay. What's my time again? Preach the word. I'm preaching the word. Let's do the word. Endeavor. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. Endeavor. Say endeavor. Endeavor to keep the unity in the spirit and the bond of peace. Endeavor. The word endeavor means to labor. Labor for victory. It means to strain with all you have. Let me tell you something. Paul was speaking to the church in Ephesus, and he knew something. The work for unity is not easy. You've got to labor for it. You've got to work for it. You've got to strain every nerve for it. You're not going to wake up on the morning and say, oh, I feel like this. Lord, bless me with the spirit of unity. And then every conflict in your life dissipates. It ain't. It's not. God, change my heart so I don't get offended? Yes, that'll work. I give you my immaturity, God? Yes. God, I'm sensitive about everything about me. Father, I just ask you to help me, Jesus. That's pretty good. But what he's saying is I got to work and endeavor daily in my life to maintain good relationships and unity in the body of Christ. Do you want victory in this house? Then you want to work every day for unity and the bond of the Spirit. Amen? You want to have peace in your life. The church started out in peace. In fact, in Acts chapter 2, verse 1, we could all quote it together, but they were gathered in one place with one mind and one purpose. And one accord means one purpose. When the people of God join together with one mind and one purpose, I'm going to tell you something, the power of God will fall in that place. Miracles will happen in that place. The drug addicted shackles will fall off of people in that place. Those that are shackled down by the enemy are set free in that place. You see, the church needs to have a unified purpose, because when we are in unity, God will shift a territory. When supernatural things happen, when you have unity, When we stop fighting and being concerned about our own selfish ambition, but we are focused on Jesus Christ and His will for our lives, miracles begin to happen. Instead of criticizing everything about the church, join in with the purpose of the church and see a miracle come. I'm not fighting just to have a good sermon or to have a good praise and worship or to have a good this or a good that. I want to see my bloodline empowered by God. I'm not fighting to have one good Sunday morning message or preach a little harder or do this or that. I want to see the Philippines know Jesus Christ every day. I want to see Zoe's nation come to Jesus Christ in a way that drug addiction is broken off. I'm touched by that. We have an opportunity to intercede for the Philippines. The president of the Philippines right now is going in by the arm of the flesh, killing people that are drug addicted and pushing drugs. The military cannot solve that problem. They need Jesus. Amen? You see, when the church becomes the church, not a social group, not a club that you can get in or out of. We're talking about literally when the church becomes the church. When the body of Christ becomes the body of Christ. Then it doesn't matter about what denomination you are or how long you've been saved or what color your skin is. It doesn't matter about those things. We are joined together as the body of the living Christ. It's time to see revival. When that church comes to one place with one mind and one purpose, you see an outpouring that pushes hell back. Drug addiction is broken. Poverty is broken. You know what Bastrop needs? The favor of God on it. Vision and hope. Our leaders have to have insight from God. If they cannot see our town prospering, then they will never plan the direction for it. They need vision and hope from God. Our town, our area, our family needs hope. The church was born out of unity. The enemy wants chaos, but God brings revival with purpose. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, Paul is admonishing the church to stay in unity. He says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort provided by love, any fellowship in the Spirit, if any affection or mercy, complete my joy. Be in the same mind, having the same love, being united in the Spirit, having one purpose. Look, this is what he's asking the church. He's saying, look, listen to me. If you want to bring joy to my life as a minister, I'm saying to you, have the same mind, the same love, be united in spirit, having one purpose. Isn't that powerful? What if in this hour our church fathers could stand before us and admonish us and look upon all of the great things that God has done through the generations? They are crying out to us in this hour. The world needs revival. And they're saying to us from that cloud of witnesses, don't cast away the revival that we've all paid a price for. My father, in the cloud of witnesses, we see so many leaders that have impacted our lives. Now it's your turn to impact lives. Tell me about the leaders who touched your life. Derek Prince, Oral Roberts, right? Tell me about the leaders that because of their faithfulness, your life was changed. Now it's time for you to be faithful. It's time for you to see revival because the next generation has got to see hope in Christ. And the only way that we can do that is if we have the same mind, the same love, united by the Spirit and having one purpose. Paul continues and he says, have these things instead of being motivated by selfish ambition and vanity. Each of you should, in humility, be moved to treat one another as more important than yourselves. You see, if you want to walk in unity and have the vision, the fire of God upon your life, we have to literally consider others more highly than we consider ourselves. We have to cast off selfish ambition and vanity. Not easy. But we are one body with one hope, one faith, one Christ. And we must come together with one purpose. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11, and then chapter 3, 1 through 11. There was some strife in the church going. There was some contention going on. And Paul was constantly dealing with these items in the body of Christ. It's not easy being a pastor. It's not. Some people think that you only work 2 days a week because you preach on Sunday. Right, so this is you work a lot trying to keep the train in on the tracks. It's not easy. If it was easy, I guess everybody would do it. In verse 11 says, "For it has been declared unto me of you, my brethren, that by which are of the house of Cleo, that there are some contentions among you." 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11. So we got this house, the house of Cleo. I didn't do my research about the house of Cleo, and I had to actually go in. I wanted to ask Mama, I said, "You seen Cleo in the Bible?" Because I want to be sure I was saying it right. And I was like, "Well, yeah, that's Cleo." And I went and Googled it and did the little thing and hit the button. Cleo came out. Didn't seem so spiritual. But he said, "Because the house of Cleo, there are some contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I am of Paul, I am Apollos, I am of Caiaphas, I am of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were ye baptized in the name of Paul?" He mad. I can feel the heat coming off of him. I love that. Because you remember last week I told you that they were criticizing Paul. They said, your words are strong in letters, but you're not very imposing in person. You see, Paul would write these fantastic letters, then he'd show up. And then like, "You the one that wrote that?" They were trying to diminish his authority as an apostle. "So you write good, but you ugly." It's true. "Is Christ divided? Paul crucified for you. Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you." He's saying, why in the world is the body of Christ worried about what tribe you're from? We are all the body of Christ. Amen? And then in chapter 3, "And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as in spiritual, but as unto carnal, as in babes of Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat hitherto, that you are not able to bear it, neither are you able to. For ye are yet carnal. For whereas among you there's envying, strife, divisions, are you not carnal and walk as men?" I hope this is a good message for you guys, because I'm talking about victory today. Amen? If your path to victory comes from peace and security in the Lord, and you're actually walking in forgiveness and compassion, that is the maturity. That shows maturity of a believer. When a believer can go through a hard thing and not come out damaged, that's maturity. But when you have a believer who's been in the way for 20, 30, 50 years, but yet they operate in strife and envy and they have divisions and they're hating everybody, then I tell you, they are children. Yeah. That's what Paul said. When you have somebody that has every right to be offended but chooses to walk in compassion, that is maturity. When you look at somebody that's gone through a war and you go to them and say, how did you survive this and keep your heart right? That's maturity. That's an example that should be admonished and brought before the body of Christ. And we should say to that person, teach me. Teach me how to walk in peace. Because I'm going to tell you, if I'd have gone through what you went through, it would have been a lot more bloody. Have you ever been there? It hurt. Life hurts, and we get wounded. And we have broken relationships, and they hurt every day. But God is the one that can redeem them. So maybe you won't. Maybe you are estranged from your family. Give it to the Lord and seek Him. Get a vision of seeing yourself being appreciated by those in your life that you love. But we cannot walk in envying or strife or divisions. Because if we operate in those things, and please, I ask you, examine your own heart. Do a list and do a calendar. How many hours a week do you fight? Seriously, this is funny, right? I'm just pulling it out of the AA manual. They make them do a calendar in Alcoholics Anonymous. I've never been a member. But I'm just saying, they do use it. How much do you drink in a week? Because what they want somebody to see is how much are you abusing the substance? It's accountability. But first you have to become aware that you're abusing a substance. And if you're, before you know it, if you're going through a lot of stuff, then you need to look on the paper and see just where's your money going? Right? Well, in the body of Christ, if we got people that are addicted to strife, and the first thing we can do is get a bit of calendar out and find out how many hours a week do I fight? How many hours a week do I pray with the right heart? But how much am I giving my life? How much am I building peace in my life? How many lives have I positively impacted, and how many situations am I in that are carnal? I'm just saying an awareness. And if you become a person that operates in unconditional love, you will see God move on your behalf in ways that you thought never possible. Relationships that you thought were over and damaged and could not be restored would be restored. Amen? You know, God knows the heart. He knows how much we love and how much we hurt. And He will restore. I feel that for a couple of you in this room. Don't give up on your kids, even if you haven't talked to them in months or years. Amen? Because it's your babies. I don't care how old they are. God knows the heart, and I'm asking you, don't give up on your children. Amen? And this particular passage, and I'll close with this tonight, I'll pick up on vision as the path to revival and victory. But as Paul is speaking in this particular context, he says, how many of you are saying in verse 4, I'm of Paul or Apollos, are you not carnal? Who then is Paul and who is Apollos? But ministers by whom we believed, even as the Lord gave them to every man. So I have planted in Apollos' waters, but God is the one who gives the increase. And you see the wisdom in Paul's writings here. He's saying to the church, he's saying, get a broader perspective. You're a child if you're saying that, well, I was saved under Paul's ministry, and then, well, he was saved under Apollos' ministry. And what Paul is saying is, you're carnal because you're looking at a two-dimensional realm here. Realize something. I and Apollos are the same thing. We serve the same Jesus. He's the same revival. God is the one who has increased the church, not man. Amen? You know, it doesn't. What one interesting item about the body of Christ is that in our society, we have pastors and so forth, and they do all the work of ministry, and coming to church is the pinnacle of our Christian walk. That's not the way it was intended to be. Pastors and leaders of a church are uniting with the body of Christ to see the Great Commission accomplished. We are to go into all the world, anointed by God, to see blinded eyes open, those that are shackled in grief and oppression to be released, to see the captive set free. You see, that is the body of Christ. You see, I need you and you need me. Don't say that you're of the pulpit and I'm of the pew. Does that make sense? So if I can say that you're a minister and you are of the pulpit, then all the work of ministry falls on you. No, I'm doing the work that God's called me to do. I am declaring his word this morning to see revival in your life. But at the end of the day, you have got to take that word. You've got to see that vision. You've got to see revival in your home and in your church and in your area and in your family. You have got to be a minister of the gospel in your life. You have to take the word of God. When you can fight with those that are around you, you have to choose to encourage. Where is the strength in the body of Christ? Where is the hope of revival in the church? I'm asking you today, can you see revival? Then work for it. Pray for it. Believe for it. Unite for it. You should ally and partner with every person around you, and you should let minor disputes fall away. Why? Because you have a greater purpose. That's what Paul was saying to the church. Drop this contention about whether or not you're of me or of Apollos. You've got to unite together. Drop these petty disputes and start talking about God's increase. We're building the kingdom, amen? I want to see revival in Southeast Arkansas and Northeast Louisiana because that's where we have influence. I want to see your families and your homes restored. I want to see not just our church, but every church in this territory full of the power of the Holy Spirit. That's every denomination. I don't care how it manifests. I want a sovereign move of God in every church in our area. Amen. When I was pastoring here, I had unity with pastors in Monroe and in this area. Very uncommon. They would send their people to my church because they understood that we had a gift of restoration and deliverance. So they would send people that were counseling, and they have trained PhD counselors there, but they would send some of their people to this church because they knew the Spirit of God was here for revival. Sometimes I would send some of our people to go to their churches because they had a certain gifting that was beneficial and they needed it. I never worried about whether or not they would leave, that my members would leave my church and go to their church. And they never were concerned that I would steal their members from their church. They just knew I had a gift, they have a gift, and we honored, came together, and we saw victory. You know, do you know how hard that is? But you know where it was born from? Every Tuesday morning for 3 years, I met privately with two pastors in a back office of their church, and we sought God from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. for 3 years every Tuesday morning. They trusted me. I trusted them. And we said, hey, we can't do it all, but we can work together to get this right. Amen. And so what I'm asking you in this place, if you would stand to your feet, is just remember the first aspect of your path to victory, it's going to be through peace and unity. Today, I want you to do something. I want you to reach out to someone that God has laid on your heart for peace. They may not even know how to accept it, but if there's a situation, a person that's on your mind at night and you have dreams and you wish it was right, pick up the phone and just say, I want to call you and I'm sorry.
I'm sorry you got hurt.
Be nice to somebody when they get your order wrong at lunch today. Right? When they bring you sweet tea instead of unsweet tea. When your steak is overcooked instead of undercooked. Right? Then you bless them when you still give them a good tip. Because maybe they're having a hard day. Amen? Don't treat somebody that waits your table as if, well, I won't go there. But be nice. How about today, start a process of, number one, cherishing those that are closest to you. And tell them, look them in the eye, and say, I want you to know something. I really appreciate that you're a part of my life. Because I'm better for it. And Dan, you should have said that much louder than that. There you go. She paid for your lunch today, probably. But those people that have chosen to journey with you in life, look at them and look them in the eyes and just say, you know, I thank you for putting up with me. I appreciate it. I know it's not easy. I really thank you that we are joined together and building life together, right? Tell your kids that. I'm thankful that you are my children, that God blessed me with you. I wasn't the perfect parent. And I'm sorry where I've ever let you down. I've ever said anything against you that have hurt you. I want you to know I'm sorry. I just want the best for you, I promise. You see, all these moments gather up, and in the body of Christ, if there is something happening in here that I'm unaware of, then look around and say, you know, I want you to know something. I love you. Amen? Finally, if you have nothing in your life that you are upset about or anything like that, there's no strife in your life, you just love, 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 keep on loving and keep on being grateful. Amen? Because I'm going to tell you, gratefulness will get you so far in life. Be grateful for the preacher that stands behind this pulpit and preaches the word. Because thank God somebody still wants to preach the word. Amen? You know, sometimes the services may not be full of the fire of the Holy Spirit. Other times they will be. But be thankful you got somebody who's pressing into God to see it. Amen? So maybe I may not have the best message. Maybe I may not articulate the point that sounds the best, but be grateful that I'm the one that I'm preaching it. Amen.